So we're saying here that there's something we can't normally see. Why can't we normally see it? Do we need drugs to do this? Is that really necessary? No, it isn't necessary. What these entheogens do is show us a mechanism that has been drummed out of us. So the brain we see basically as a neurological computer all too often. That's what it does. But what it also is a filtering system. So what I see is the potential for a massive amount of information, of data, of energy to flow into us. But it's blocked by a series of filters. And we can give names to some of those filters. Social normalizing, mainstream uneducation, control system conditioning, sensorial containment, dimensional containment. So the smart person will look at that without any need of anything else and say, well, yeah, social normalizing is not necessary. I will do what I want, thank you. Mainstream uneducation. As soon as you begin to educate yourself and take it upon yourself to become intellectual, to become apprised of the information, to become smart, you realize that the mainstream system is not concerned with educating us, quite the reverse. So we can do away with that. Control system conditioning. The fact that we're just little people and we can't do anything. That we're on this one-dimensional timeline. We can do away with that. If we're really smart, we can do away with it. Where the entheogens come into their own is in this sensorial containment. The fact that we are supposedly trapped in a world of sense, in Maya, in the world of sensory information. Entheogens can help to do something about that, to temporarily remove it and show how that isn't necessarily the case. Dimensional containment, to move you out of your temporal time zone as a three-dimensional human being. When you do that, you think, oh, okay, yeah, now I can see the whole thing. Now I can see the objects of trans-dimensional existence because I do not have those filters in place. So this is a process that is designed to be completely natural, completely organic. It does not require anything external. And so why are these substances there? They're there to remind us of a process that we can do completely organically. I was speaking about this with a lady earlier. She says, I can see things. I can see energies. I can do stuff. I don't need those. And I said, that is fantastic because you represent what it should be like. Some people need a kick up the ass. See, I've been in America. Arse, sorry, that's better. Some people need a reminder. Again, this comes down to male-female. Males have a distinct disadvantage in this case. The way males are trained to be brought up in this country and others is as reductionists, nuts and bolts thinkers. You cannot get anywhere solely with that rationale. Critical reason is important, but it has a space and it has a place and it has a time and it has a frequency. Women tend to have more intuitive faculties that go openly throughout the whole life. As I move through my life, I find that most women I meet remain open-minded for the duration of their life. Most men tend to shut down more and more every 10, every 7 years, whatever. Now, this is changing. The flow of energies between the two, the female and the male within any individual, is becoming more harmonic, more reliable, more consistent. So what this teaches us is that it isn't just the mind that sees, it isn't just the eyes that see, it's the body. The body as a system of aerials, body as percipient. And as you may have seen in other systems, the body houses a system of energy portals. There are 7 key ones, there are another 7 subtle ones, another 7 even more subtle ones, but these are the main ones. And they have specific functions. So if all your energy is being filtered through the brow and the throat, then you'll do well because you can communicate well, you have some kind of psychic impulse. But unless all those portals are open, the energy that we talk about cannot flow through the system properly. You miss parts of the spectrum. And these portals, of course, as you guessed, are more commonly kind of known as chakras, spinning wheels of energy, also known as seals, bands, assemblage points, decoders, vortices, whatever. But they are there. And they represent a potential energy interpretation in the body that goes below the level of words, below the level of information as pure energy. And significantly, this portal here that we would associate with what we call the heart, which isn't really anything to do with the heart, but that's that meme, we associate with it because it works on an emotional feeling level, to use those words, is distinctly female, and it has the biggest, furthest reach of any system. It can reach from across the planet, across the galaxy. It's the most powerful thing we have, is that pull. Everything else is secondary to that. Everything else is secondary to that. If the heart portal is not open, we are silenced. So the most important thing to do is to be aware of that and to understand that that valve can be opened and closed as appropriate. We don't have to turn into space bunnies and just hop about blissfully everywhere waiting for 2012 unitary consciousness, because that won't necessarily happen and it won't necessarily help us. We have to learn how to switch these energy portals on and off, open and close them as necessary. And going back to this perspective on the object of existence, that is the reach from that heart portal, from truth, from impeccability, from authentic being. That is what flows through that energy level. Anything that is inauthentic begins to shut down the other portals. Salvia is an interesting entheogen. It's still legal here in the UK at the moment. I bought some over the counter also in New York last month. Totally legal, totally fine. This is what it looks like in its native habitat. It's a sage mint plant, very beautiful. Basically, it comes from Oaxaca in Mexico, in isolated mountain regions, typically very wet, drenched areas. There's a long tradition of usage by the Mazatec shamans. It can be smoked, chewed, you can make a tea or a tincture from it. The primary psychoactive component of this is a thing called salvin RNA, which was only recently really uncovered. There's a guy called Daniel Siebert who was doing a lot of sterling work on this front and extracted this, and you can make an extract of it. Because actually doing things with the plant is very difficult and time-consuming and problematical. And it's known as a kappa opioid receptor agonist. Basically, most other visionary plants are alkaloids and affect different receptors in the brain. This one is unusual. It's the only one that tickles that receptor. And salvia is very interesting. I mean, on the street, not on the street, but in the stores, it looks like this. You get a little container about that big, and it's got what looks like, you know, sage that you'd put on your cooking or whatever. For those of you who haven't seen it, this is what it looks like. And it can be, as I said earlier, it can be created in a number of different formats. The effects of salvia are very interesting. It brings about a deep recapitulation process very often. Helps you revisit stuff in your life, not necessarily just childhood memories, anything, but specifically those first formative 7 or 14 years. We would call that regressive therapy nowadays. Salvia does that. Visions of moving through membranes are often associated with this. The feeling of moving through things, moving through dimensional spaces, I would say, from the 3D to a space where there is no time. Being in several locations at once. This is what physicists may call multidimensionality. Particle being in two spaces at the same time, quantum bilocation, whatever. Encounters with other beings, contact with inorganic beings, non-carbon-based life forms. Classic effects of salvia, this happens a lot. It's extremely important to note with any entheogenic information that you hear from me or anyone else, all this stuff requires discipline, intelligence, courage, responsibility, and a certain amount of integrity. And if any one of those things is lacking, this is a foolish path for anybody to even consider. So any recreational use of this is pointless. It's not a recreational substance, it doesn't work like that. Any entheogen needs those 5 characteristics to be brought into any meaningful experience. Anything that has dubious or illegal connotations also, we don't want to get locked up for doing anything like this. So one has to be very careful. Recently, these guys here from various rather esteemed places in this kind of realm of therapeutic research in pharmacology, ethnopharmacology, ethnobotany, have made some suggestions about Salvia divinorum. They suggest that it may help treat Alzheimer's. There's growing evidence to show that. Bipolar disorder, which is increasingly afflicting this country and the states. and obviously many other places, but those that we hear most about